rock stars have an average life expectancy of 37. They often die in mysterious and tragic circumstances. And for their fans, it's hard to accept that they've really gone.
The human instinct is to fill in the blanks. Why? Why did this happen? And that's where the conspiracy theories come in.
Not death by heroin overdose, right? Not choking on his own vomit. Jimi Hendrix drowned to death.
There are some very odd things about the death of John Lennon. And one strong possibility is Mark David Chapman was a program killer.
Anyone that thinks that Bob Marley was not under surveillance, under suspicion, under threat, is very naive.
Kurt Cobain did not commit suicide. There was a conspiracy to murder him.
Tupac Shakur is the latest assassination by a local hit squad tied to the police department, but with federal oversight.
You talk about the CIA and you talk about MI5 and the mafia, but nobody talks about stalkers. Maybe people should think more in terms of stalkers.
Jimi Hendrix came to London in 1966. With bassist Noel Redding and drummer Mitch Mitchell, he formed the Jimi Hendrix Experience. Massive success followed. But in September 1970, his rise was cut short.
I was in New York in my hotel room. I got a phone call saying that Jimi Hendrix is dead.
I was devastated. Very upset. I'd only seen him the day before.
He was found unconscious by his girlfriend, Monica Danneman. He had overdosed on her sleeping tablets. She called an ambulance.
They checked his pulse, they checked his eyes, and one of the ambulance men told Monica, and I'm repeating what Monica told me, don't worry, he'll be okay in the afternoon. We've got cases like that all the time.
But Jimi Hendrix wasn't okay. At the hospital, he was declared dead on arrival. The official cause of death, inhalation of vomit due to barbiturate intoxication. But the coroner's report left an open verdict, out of which conspiracy theories have grown. One, that Hendrix was assassinated.
Jimi Hendrix drowned to death. What is it you hear about? He choked on his own vomit, right? Oh yeah. The surgeon cleared his throat and great volumes of red wine came gushing out of his lungs and his stomach. But Hendrix had one little glass of wine before he went to bed, right? And my reconstruction of the assassination of Jimi Hendrix has him held down while gallon or 2 gallons of wine are poured down his throat until he drowns.
I don't know. I know that he had drunk an amount of red wine. There's a possibility that the red wine could have been poured down his throat, yeah, there is. But I don't know.
The red wine was originally mentioned by one of the doctors who tried to revive him. Some conspiracy theorists suggest Hendrix's manager, Mike Jeffrey, could have killed him.
His manager actually had a life insurance policy in his own name from Jimi Hendrix, so he did have a personal benefit. And he also did claim to own the entire work of Jimi Hendrix's music catalog.
All sorts of substandard music was released, but the record companies profited handsomely.
But surely Mike Jeffrey would have profited much more from a living Jimi Hendrix.
Why would he want to kill Jimi? Jimi could have rolled on forever, making him millions. No, definitely, definitely not.
Hey, Joe. 25 years on, another Hendrix death theory. His ex-girlfriend, Kathy Etchingham, commissioned her own investigation and came to another conclusion.
Jimi was stalked and fell into the hands of his stalker.
She believes that Monica Danneman was responsible for his death, and that Monica had only met Jimi Hendrix days beforehand.
Jimi was trying to get rid of Monica, to sort of shake her off, and she just wasn't going to let go.
But others believe that Monica and Jimmy had been friends and lovers for 18 months, and they had a strong relationship.
If you look at the poem that Jimmy wrote, The Story of Life, that night, in Monica's flat, and he instructed her to do the artwork for his next album, would anybody in their right mind do these things while they're trying to get rid of someone?
Although Kathy does not claim that Monica set out to kill Jimi Hendrix, she does think Monica was an obsessed fan.
I don't think she wanted him to leave that night, so she gave him the tablets, told him they were weak. She woke up about 6 o'clock in the morning and found Jimmy choking. She then phoned Eric Burdon.
Saying, help, I can't wake Jimmy up. And I'm thinking, what's anybody want to wake Jimmy up for? You know, he never gets up till midday anyway.
She was asking for advice, what should we do?
She was frantic. I can't get an ambulance, this hashish in the place.
She knew if Jimmy found himself waking up in a hospital that he would not be very happy, because it would have been a big scandal.
I said, just forget that, just get an ambulance.
Kathy believes hours went past while the flat was cleaned of drugs. That when the ambulance was eventually called and arrived at 11:27 a.m., Jimi Hendrix was already dead.
The ambulance men say that when they got there, the door was open and there was no one present except for the body on the bed, covered in vomit. It was a simple conspiracy of incompetence. That's what it was.
For others, Monica did do everything she could have done.
I just cannot see her being negligent in something like this, you know? It just wasn't her. Absolutely not.
I didn't mean to take up all your sweet time. For years, Monica's version of events was criticized, but she fought back. Then in 1996, Kathy Etchingham successfully sued Monica to stop her from libeling Kathy. Within days of the verdict, Monica Daneman killed herself.
There were a lot of press people who believed her side of the story, but there were also others who didn't, and she fell prey to the system.
He fell into the hands of a crazy fan. And why she did it, we don't know and we'll never know. She took that secret to her grave, you know, so.
Mr. Lennon was struck several times. We're not positive at this time as to how many times he was struck.
He's not dead. They're just saying that.
The doctor just announced it.
Yes, but I don't care. They're just saying that to get people to leave. He's not dead. John Lennon can't be dead.
Hardly any rock death caused as much grief as the murder of the pivotal member and social conscience of the Beatles, John Lennon. On December the 8th, 1980, he was gunned down outside his apartment on New York's Upper West Side. Mark David Chapman had asked John Lennon for his last autograph. The assassin remained at the scene. He pleaded guilty to murder.
Because Mark David Chapman never did have a trial, there's never really been any evidence presented one way or the other as to his, you know, possible other connections or other people involved. So, you know, there's a big space there for conspiracy theorists to jump in.
Who wanted John Lennon destroyed? Right, just as Reagan has come into power, as the right is reestablishing itself, right, discrediting the left, you know, throughout the 1970s and 80s and beyond.
His answer is the CIA. Lennon had been a leading peace campaigner in the 70s, and had just re-emerged after a four-year break from music. Conspiracy theorists believe the CIA employed an advanced manipulation technique on the assassin, mind control.
Mark David Chapman went through programming in Hawaii, right? According to letters that I have from first-hand witnesses that I've never revealed anywhere, right? But I have the names of his programmer. And also you have Mark David Chapman's own words, right? In the courtroom, he declared himself guilty. Right, but this is only because voices came to him and told him to plead guilty while he was awaiting trial.
The last programming stage supposedly happened just after Chapman left Hawaii.
The official view is that the reason for Chapman leaving Honolulu was simply to kill Leonard, to stalk him and kill him. That did not happen. When I was in Honolulu, a very amiable police officer said that Chapman left with his grandmother. And he didn't go to New York, he went to Chicago. I checked this out with three different sources.
Fenton Bresler is convinced that Chicago was the final instruction point.
There was someone in Chicago whom he met with, whom he knew, and who turned him round, as I say. He was his controller.
Destroy, kill all hippies.
The actual programming these days is done electronically. And when Mark David Chapman heard a voice in his head, it's very possible that that was an electromagnetic device, right, capable of communicating with the auditory pathways of the brain.
Mark David Chapman was found reading Catcher in the Rye. For conspiracy theorists, this novel was the triggering device. But despite the fact that John Lennon had ceased to be the revolutionary figure of the 1970s, and not a shred of evidence to back up the mind control theory, conspiracy theorists are not dissuaded.
And now you have a very conservative country with no John Lennon to speak up in opposition. In fact, many of those characters from the 60s and 70s who opposed fascism, right, are no longer here. And they all died under mysterious circumstances.
One of them was Bob Marley. As he died of cancer, you might think his death was not particularly mysterious. But never underestimate the CIA. 1976 was election year in Jamaica. The country was in political turmoil.
The Caribbean was a hotbed of espionage. You had, on one hand, the Cubans. You had, on the other hand, the KGB. You had, on another hand, British intelligence. And you had the CIA. So I think that anyone that thinks that Bob Marley was not under surveillance, under suspicion, under threat, is very naive.
The CIA would have been delighted to get him out of the way. He was identified at that time as the most powerful black man on earth. And the CIA was keeping files on him.
Although Marley's sympathies lay with the left-wing prime minister, he planned a free concert to bring both sides together.
Bob's statements to me were, you know, I really don't want to make any more money off the Jamaican people. So let's do something for free so everybody can come. Because at that time, the country was in a turmoil. People were dumb.
People were dying. And Bob's role was to try to lift people above this kind of internecine warfare.
But unintentionally, it became very political. And days before the concert, gunmen attacked Marley's home.
It was a very professional assault. It wasn't an amateur assault, a very professional assault.
Bob Marley, his wife Rita, and his manager were shot.
We have been explained to by Prime Minister Jamaica that it was a mixture of the CIA and the local opposition party.
I've never seen any proof of that. I would love to find some proof of that. But in all these years of research, I've never found the smoking gun.
The three survived, and Bob Marley started touring abroad. But for conspiracy theorists, the CIA continued to pursue Marley and sent an agent.
That agent directly told Bob Marley that he would be murdered if he returned to Jamaica.
And in keeping with that alleged threat, the CIA employed a different technique to target Bob Marley.
I've heard that someone gave Bob a pair of boots, and that Bob put his foot in the boots and, you know, these boots, what's wrong with them? And he put his hand inside, and at the tip of the boot, he found a piece of copper wire, curved almost needle-like.
Within months, Bob Marley broke his toe playing football. Shortly afterwards, he was diagnosed with cancer in his toe. The cancer spread.
Years later, I was watching ABC News, and one former CIA officer just happened to say, if I were to kill somebody and not have it be known, I would give them a pair of boots. They'd put their foot into it. They would get cancer of the foot. It would spread, metastasize, and they would die of brain cancer. And I was just floored.
There is no scientific evidence of induced cancers. That and the fact that Marley produced a large part of his work after he was diagnosed does not dissuade conspiracy theorists. However, in May 1981, Bob Marley died. Many more people believe in the conspiracy theory arising from the death of Kurt Cobain, lead singer of Nirvana. On the 5th of April 1994, the famous Seattle grunger committed suicide. Or did he?
Well, the official version is that Kurt Cobain, brightest light of his generation in the field of rock music, committed suicide with a Remington Model 11 20-gauge shotgun in the garage of his Seattle home. There were no witnesses.
Rumors spread quickly. His credit card was used after he shot himself, but before the body was found. There were no fingerprints on the shotgun. There are doubts about the suicide note.
What we have now, after some of these documents have been released, is an opportunity to examine what Cobain's signature looked like on the so-called suicide note and compare it to the signature that they had in their files. And they certainly should have discovered that the two signatures could not possibly be more distinct.
Richard Lee also claims a photograph of the death scene shows he could not have shot himself in the left temple.
This was the photograph that was published the day after he died on the front page of the Seattle Times. And the very same day, the rival newspaper, the PI, reported that Cobain had shot himself in the left temple, which he would think, given that he was using an extremely powerful weapon, would have sent several pounds of blood and brain to the right of the body. And yet there it is, right on the front page of the newspaper, and not a drop of blood is to be seen anywhere.
The autopsy revealed lethal levels of Valium and heroin in Cobain's system. Would he have been capable of pulling the trigger?
He basically had OD'd on drugs. Now, at the point that he had shot himself filled with heroin, he could not have picked up that shotgun and blown himself in the head. That implies that there was another gunman. And it also implies perhaps that his drugging was an attempt to keep him subdued so he could be shot easily there.
If he was incapable of shooting himself, who would have had a motive to do it?
You have to look at the spouse as probably the first person on the list that should be suspect, because of course they get all the money.
Kurt Cobain's widow, Courtney Love, inherited the Kurt Cobain estate. There are unfounded rumors that she ordered a hitman. She has always vehemently denied it.
The thought that she was together enough to do it, no. They were both, as a result of their drug use, were often in a situation where they were struggling to cope, frankly.
There were also rumors that Cobain was going to retire from music.
He was also planning of basically leaving his band and retiring from music, according to some sources. A lot of money could be lost there. Perhaps it's more worthwhile to knock them off and make them a martyr and keep churning out their old stuff. And when you look at it like that, yeah, a lot of people could have been interested in knocking him off who weren't named Courtney Love.
Assassinated, drugged and shot, whatever conspiracy you'd like to believe, the fact is Cobain joined Club 27. Rockers Janis Joplin, Jim Morrison, Jimi Hendrix, and now Kurt all died at the age of 27.
Kurt Cobain blew his brains out. Simple as that. It's quite, there we go, that's what happened. So just deal with that. Love his music or whatever, but that's the way he is. He wasn't a superhero. He was a flawed guy. He was a drug addict and he was depressed. He got shot. There we go.
Rap, hip-hop, has been scarred by numerous deaths. Tupac Shakur was one of the most notorious gangster rappers of the 90s. On September the 7th, 1996, in Las Vegas, Tupac was shot after leaving a Tyson fight with his manager, Suge Knight. For some, the circumstances were mysterious.
It was bumper-to-bumper traffic, tons of people on the road, and how a car was able to come up and actually stop next to Tupac's is rather curious in itself. But a gunman stuck his hand out the window and opened fire on the passenger side of the car.
Tupac was shot in the chest and died within 7 days. Many suspected that the camp of his greatest rival, East Coast rap star Biggie Smalls, or notorious B.I.G., was behind it.
The biggest conspiracy view that's come out is that Biggie Smalls' camp conspired to have Tupac Shakur killed because of a feud.
This view seemed to be confirmed when 6 months later, Biggie was gunned down in spookily similar circumstances. Conspiracy theorists believe that gang violence is a fabrication to cover up the real assassins of obstinate rappers.
Tupac Shakur is the latest assassination, right, by a local hit squad tied to the police department, but with federal oversight. And the same can be said for the killing of notorious B.I.G.
That's pure speculation, but some believe the FBI did have Tupac under surveillance on the night of his shooting.
His mother was a Black Panther, his godfather was a Black Panther, he was raised around Black Panthers, he had FBI agents following him around when he was a teenager.
She believes the police handled the death badly. They didn't secure the scene of the crime immediately and failed to interview the only willing witness. The assailant's white Cadillac disappeared into the night. And some theorists are suspicious of undercover police.
You have undercover cops, right, who are following Tupac and notorious B.I.G. They witness a murder, right? They don't come forward to describe the suspect. They don't give the license plate number. They don't describe the car. As a matter of fact, they all keep their mouths shut, and that's the famous blue wall of silence that goes on whenever the police are culpable in something. He was a very political figure, and that's the kind of musician that gets taken out. Same with notorious B.I.G. and the other rappers.
No evidence at all links the police to Tupac's killing. Indeed, some don't believe Tupac is actually dead.
Still, some people say he's alive, and I really don't know the truth.
He gotta still be alive, you know. My words is I think he's still alive.
He could be though. I'm not gonna say he's not dead.
There was no autopsy photos actually released when he had been shot. He was always talking about being buried, yet he was cremated. No one ever saw the body at all.
Perhaps he could have faked his death. The fact that he called one of his albums, Machiavelli, the Don Illuminati, the 7 Day Theory, is symbolic for that.
He changed his name to Machiavelli after Niccolo Machiavelli.
He took the name Machiavelli, which was a person who faked his own death to fool his enemies.
Uh-huh.
And Tupac has some enemies.
Go ahead, girl, tell the truth.
The 7 Day Theory, which is interesting, that was the other side to the title. Tupac took 7 days to die. Plus, at the end of his album, he actually gets shot in the same way that he died in reality. Or whatever reality is, or if he's dead or not.
Man, I've been struggling trying to get in here a long time. You're gonna have to earn your way.
This video, which depicts him in heaven, was released days after he died.
Oh yeah, yeah. He did this video called I Ain't Mad At Ya, where he's doing the video in heaven, which was another weird thing as well. Either Tupac completely prophesized his death, which could have happened, but at the same time, he did know something. He seemed to know something. Either he had a death wish and just talked about his death all the time, which he did, but all the other stuff after his death seemed a bit, it just seems a bit too weird.
The Elvis conspiracy theories show how half-baked ideas can circulate for decades, simply because the theories are intriguing. They never have an ending because we'll never know the full truth. The theories say a lot about the status of rock stars, our superheroes, idols, gods. But they also say a lot about those who can't let go of their obsessions.
I think that mentality is kind of sad for me. I don't want to say it is, but it is, you know. It's a bit sad that you have to live your life for somebody else. Realize they're dead, get on with your life. A lot of the times when they kill themselves, they've killed themselves. That's it, let them be, let them rest, man. You don't have to, you know, do something else, really.